Welcome to Magical Moments with Elena Chapman, the place for you to break free from the norm and celebrate your life, because what we believe in our hearts becomes our reality. This is Magical Moments with Elena Chapman.
Welcome to Magical Moments for that ease and that betterment in your life. And I'm your host, Elena Chapman. And we have this show doing all this ease and betterment in your life. And I'm telling you, you know, I was thinking yesterday, this is going to be our magical nugget, guys. I was thinking yesterday, how are people keeping that ease and flow? Well, they have to have strength. And I started talking because, you know, you're being fed constantly doubting terrible news. You know, with this coronavirus, you're getting, oh my gosh, you're hearing about death every day. You're hearing about inadequacy every day. You're hearing about threat. It's threat to our lives. It's threat to our well-being. And all right. But then I started thinking about, see, I go on these thoughts. I started thinking about strength. Where does that come from? Well, when everything is peachy keen in our life, it's easy to be strong. However, when everything is hard, then that strength wanes, you know, and it hides in many other ways. Like we whine, we blame, we criticize, but that is not strength. Now, if you look up strength in the dictionary, it'll say things like power to resist force, strong or inherent assets, being more forceful. We haven't been taught to be strong. We have taught to be followers. We have been taught to be good workers. We have been taught to be consumers, but we haven't been taught to be strong. Can you foster strength? Yes, you can foster strength, because I think that strength, and this is not in the Webster dictionary, strength really is something that comes inside you that is this knowing. It's a big knowing that you will always be well. And it's really calling upon something bigger than yourself. Every crisis I've ever had in my life, I started thinking back every time, and Lord knows I have had a wingdinger life where I have had a lot of things I've had to work through. There was a time when I only had $200 in my pocket. There was a time when I had a terrible time for my kids and myself, where we were attacked. I've had all these incredible events that I really started thinking, what got me through it? And it was that incredible feeling that I wasn't alone, that I did not have to carry this load by myself. And that is what strength, that is strength, because it helps you to kick in to, instead of being in the worry and the blame and the criticism, it helps you to go instead to the spirit, the creative spirit. How can I get Lysol and chlorine and toilet paper into my house? You know, not, oh my God, they don't have it. Somebody's hoarding. How dare they hoard? See, I can go two ways. But when I'm knowing that something's bigger, I know it's out there. It's just, I have to use my creative self to solve the problem. It's a different way of thinking. But when you do the blame, when you start pointing that finger, when you start thinking you can't do, my God, you aren't going to be able to do it. You're going to be so stuck in that cycle. That's a whole different place. You just jump to a different place, and it's not a place of strength. And that leads us, so that's my nugget. Today, today with this, I'll give you a little bit. I really would like it if you would start to look at things that build your faith in yourself and your faith in your something bigger. Something bigger. And when you do that, so let's see, what can we do? Number one, listen to this show. This helps to build you. So this one, or also look up Troward on the internet, or O'Donohue, or the Tao. There are plenty of things that you can do to start building your faith. And then your faith in yourself. Well, that is what we're going to be talking today about, the power of our mind and what we think about ourselves. And with that, I want to talk about my wonderful guest. Mona Antoine is the founder of Mindful Leader NFP. It's a first of its kind. I love this, guys. High school elective for after-school programs in the city of Chicago. I am so happy to hear this because we need this in the schools. We need kids to really start to have more mindfulness. Do you know there is so much anxiety in the schools and high school, through college to through 30s? Those kids are, I must be getting old, I'm saying those kids. They are having so much stress. And look at now what we've given them. I mean, I just love this. So she works in the high schools. And she's dedicated to creating a positive changes in the lives of the youth through teaching them the art of mindfulness. This is a project-based series, and it equips youth with the power to ignite their light and become the first, best version of themselves. Now, Ms. Antoine, I mean, her bio is very long, but I want you to know, she brings over 18 years of intensive training in mindfulness, 12 years of mentoring youth, and 16 years of experienced working in the private sector as Harpo Studios, where she successfully created and implemented the company's very first mentorship program. With that, I want to bring on Mona. Hello, Mona.
Hello there. So happy to be here. I'm feeling good.
I'm so happy to have you on the show today. This is the perfect show for us today with mindfulness. Mindfulness is definitely the way to start getting strength within ourselves. Don't you think?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Yeah, because it is. I always say it's our thoughts, perpetual transmutation, the laws of the universe. The thoughts create everything. It's what we believe. And mindfulness helps you to change those beliefs. So with that, tell us a little bit, because not everyone out there knows. And mindfulness is a funny thing. You hear it all the time. You also hear mindfulness centers. We used to have one here in the city I live in. However, not everybody, people link it together with meditation. They think it's a meditation thing, which it's not. And we don't know. We think it's this, we think it's that, we put it in this category. What is it?
You know what? Mindfulness is just paying attention to the present moment and not having any thoughts where you're judging yourself or judging anyone else, truly being present. So if you're washing dishes, if you're cleaning a toilet, if you are teaching, whatever it is you're doing, as long as you're present and you are feeling up on the emotional scale, as humans, we live on this emotional scale, which is sad, angry, hopeful, and happy. So if you're happy and hopeful, you don't really have to zoom in. You're already practicing mindfulness because you're feeling happy. But when you're lower on the emotional scale, you're disconnected from your intuition and your higher self. And so it's hard to practice mindfulness if you're lower on the scale. Mindfulness is just paying attention to the present moment and having kind thoughts where you're not judging yourself or judging anyone else. Meditation is when you sit down for an X amount of time with your eyes closed and you say a mantra for an X amount of time.
That's the difference.
That's the difference. So we're teaching mindfulness in a 100-hour curriculum to the youth through the Mindfulness Leader non-for-profit organization. And meditation is just 1% of that.
Now, curious, now you've been doing this for a little while in the school. So what are you seeing the benefits? What is it really helping the kids with?
This is really helping them with their emotional management, which is so huge, which is something that is missing from our education system. Emotional management. You ever notice that kids get to college and then all of a sudden they drop out or commit suicide because they can't handle the pressure?
I taught in the colleges for a long time, actually.
Yeah.
So yes, I remember the freshmen, very hard. We had to give them extra support, especially, you know, we found that there were a lot of kids that were away from home for the first time. It really messed with their whole schedules. Mom and dad had always been very active in their career. They didn't know how to set up a schedule.
Yeah. Well, now high school is like college now. It's so intense.
Yeah.
You have students taking all these advanced courses, so much pressure on them, and no one is teaching them to get ahead of their anxiety and to check in where they are emotionally, and that's what we're doing.
That's because most people don't know how to deal with anxiety. They can't teach it.
We're all born with anxiety. We all have anxiety. It's not a bad thing. It's a matter of getting ahead of it with your rituals.
Yes.
So that you can sustain the way you feel and feel really good. It's like saying, you know what? Come over to my house for dinner tonight. I have a big pot and I'm going to make something really great. But really nothing is in that pot because I'm just giving you words like be positive, be mindful. We're giving out actual recipes.
Exactly. Yes,
you know,
we need
actual recipes, because words really don't teach and don't mean anything anyways. I know you know that.
No, they don't. No, it's the actual doing. And with this mindfulness. Now, I know you work with kids, but they're not kids. I don't think of my high school students as kids. I really don't. I think of them as young adults. I think of them, they are now responsible for so much more in their school than we ever were. I don't think of them as kids. But I do think that the same things that we're applying with them, that you're doing with them, should definitely fit into society.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I train teachers. I train parents. I train organizations. So I don't just work with the kids. I focus on the kids because I'm a mom. And I know growing up in this country, that wasn't available. And so I know it's my dharma in life to communicate this and teach this. And it's so exciting. I do not forget about the adults, but it seems like it's the kids that are interested in being in this curriculum, you know, investing in their own selves.
But
it's the same language for adults. And really how to get through these hard times is to figure out where you are emotionally. Check in with yourself. How am I feeling right now? Like authentically, you know what? I'm a little stressed out. I'm worried. I lost my job. I'm home all night.
Many
I'm
people have lost their jobs.
Yes. I'm homeschooling. All these things that, you know, society's been hit with, this is a great time to really pick up this ritual and start incorporating this so that you can model for your kids, your neighbors.
You know, it's so funny. When we are hit with stuff, I've been talking to a lot of people who have lost their job. I mean, many, many people we don't even think of. Like, I know photographers who were working for corporations, they lost their job. There are people that have really just, we have a lot of people out of work.
Yeah.
And we have a lot of people who are just stressed. So with this, I think when we are saying, okay, you've got to apply this and this and this, some of them are in a space where they're spinning. You know, it's like a free fall.
Yeah.
And they're just, because they can't hold on. Well, why do you think, I said it in the last show too, why do you think they're hoarding? Because it's the only way to gain control. They've lost control. And so now we're stuck in our house with people that, kids that I never used to have to see, and now I have to see, a spouse that I didn't even know existed really, but now he is here all the time. Well, I'm not married, but I'm just saying, or she's not, she's here all the time. So you have all of a sudden all this other stuff on top of losing your job. You're having to deal with the reality of this family that has kind of done its own thing.
Yeah. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, so this, how do you just say check in? You know what I mean?
So the reason people are hoarding and buying all the toilet paper and doing all this, that control falls under anger and frustration on the emotional scale.
Right.
So they're angry and they're frustrated. And when you're angry and frustrated on the emotional scale, what feels good is to have a little control. So yes, they can't control what's going on in the world, but they can control the amount of toilet paper they buy.
It's not logical at all.
It's not, but that's what they're doing.
I know.
The best
I'm
thing
sorry,
you
I
can...
I don't mean to laugh. I should yeah. laugh, but to me, it does seem so funny. Oh my gosh, we got a terrible virus. The whole world is falling apart at the seams. Nobody's working. I'm going to go out and buy toilet paper. Now, do you see how the critical mind plays with us? And that ego has to have control so badly. It has to, and it is angry and because it's not in control anymore. And my world's being torn apart. And I have to grab something. But do you see how illogical it is?
Yeah. But you know what we can do? You know what we could do really fast to just start working on ourselves when we feel like we're in that state?
Yeah.
We can really just stop and we can say, this thought that I'm having that says, okay, I'm not enough. I'm freaking out. The world's going to come to an end. Catch yourself in that thought and just pause and say, you know what? It's not true. It's not true. And then change the subject, have a kinder thought. If you go throughout your day catching these horrible thoughts and tweaking them, it makes the biggest difference. It's a game changer because what happens is we have these messed up beliefs during these hard times, during this crisis, because we keep having the same thought and then it is now our belief.
Yes.
We're going to run out of everything. I'm never going to get another job. The world's going to come to an end. Everybody's going to die. You have to take control over your thoughts.
You do.
You have to.
You know, I think at this time, and sure, we're sitting here. I get it, folks. I do. We're all sitting here saying, okay, just stop. But really, it is stopping. It is saying, all right, I'm going to take a breath. And we can all step outside, no matter where we are. Go outside. Don't look at your neighbor's house. Don't look at the cars. Look up at the sky. Look at the vastness of the sky. Now, you're going to say, Elena, seriously. No, I'm serious, because this is where you can stop and breathe. You know, when someone is in a full-fledged anxiety attack, the first thing you need to do is to touch something live. When you want to change your thoughts, you sometimes have to do an action, something different to mess it up. I always do that. So I step outside and I look at that sky, and everything in nature has something to teach us, guys. What does it have to teach you? To me, I see vastness. I see opportunity. I see endless possibility when I look at the sky. What do you see? See, this is when you can take a breath and stop the thoughts. You can just, and then you can start building from it. Am I correct, Mona?
Absolutely. When you're out there, listen to the nature, listen to the birds, listen to the wind. Now you're meditating. Now you're meditating on top of grounding yourself with the fresh air outside. And so that's a great way. That's a great way to build up for your next practice, which is a little bit of meditation, stopping those thoughts and having that garbage removal. We take the garbage out every day in our house, but do we take the garbage out in our mind every day? Because we're bombarded with a lot of information.
That's right.
And we let that garbage sit and add up. And so when you're out there, like Alina said, when you're out there, just listen. Look at the sky. Listen to the birds. Listen for the wind. Listen to your breath. And if you have a thought, that's okay. Go back. Have that thought and go back to listening to the nature outside.
You might just start having a good thought and let that one be. But you know, it's from, this is what I always compare it, because people say, but I feel like I'm doing nothing. Okay. Now, what do you answer to that, Mona? Because it is a water fire feeling. You know that. It's a water power versus fire.
Yeah. It's the most important thing you could do. you're not doing nothing. What you're doing is you're really preparing yourself emotionally and physically so that you do have something to give your child, your neighbor, your coworker, yourself. If you don't take time to just check your thoughts, then you're just going nonstop. And what are you thinking when you're going nonstop?
We don't understand how important it is. When you step outside, things are really bad. You step outside, you start to look up at the sky. You learn the lesson from that. You see the vastness. You think, my God, even in this time, there is so much opportunity. I'm looking at this wrong. It changes things. But this is the thing that's really important. Then you go back inside the house with the family, and you got this new feeling.
It's so true.
Yeah, instead of yelling at the kids for making a lava lamp and using all the plastic bags or something, you know, instead you say, hey, let me help. Or did you ever think of this idea? All of a sudden you become a creative force instead of a doomsday force. That's the difference, folks. It's that easy. And in the creative force, you can start creating. So you don't have toilet paper. All right, well, we'll use something else until I can get to the store. And it is possible. Okay? There's nothing that can't be accomplished. But if you're in that worry place, if you're in that anxiety place, it builds like a mountain. It gets so overwhelming, and it's fire, and it feeds you. And so you get sucked into it, and you let that fire spin inside you. And it feels like everyone I talk to who worries says they're doing something, but they're actually doing nothing. It's an addicting fire feeling. Can you speak a little bit about that, Mona, that addiction to the anger?
Yeah. It's so easy to get angry. I mean, it requires no control. Like when you're yelling at your child. Okay, I'm a mother. I've yelled, so I'm not perfect. But when you're yelling at your child or somebody, you're really frustrated with yourself. It's yourself that's out of control.
Yes.
No matter what anybody did. And by the time you have anxiety, you have not done these rituals like meditate, practicing the power of your mind and catching your thoughts and tweaking them, and you're full blown into anxiety, it's too late. So just be easy with yourself and then try again later on in the day. But you really can't do anything when you're in the fire and you're burning up in flames. Just wait for it to die out and develop some rituals for yourselves so that you can start to feel connected to your higher self. You can go within yourself and connect to your intuition and, you know, get that fresh air. Grounding yourself is so important. It's more important than sending that report, because you're going to send that report in your angry state and no one's going to get that.
No.
And so it's better to work on yourself and then go do that task.
You know, it's finally gotten warm here. And I went outside and I put my feet in the ground and just bare feet. I walked with bare feet. Okay. We're not that warm, but I was anxious. So I walked and I put my feet on the ground and I just felt the earth. I just allowed myself to feel the earth. And it takes 2 seconds. And then I asked the earth to come up and surround me with beauty. But you don't have to do that part. You can just feel the earth. Get yourself grounded. Start to get yourself into being in the present moment. I love to say, all the little chores you do, keep them sacred. You know, the sacredness of them. But being in the present moment is a real gift to cultivate. It's a powerful gift. Because, like when I was doing choirs, Mona, no matter what was going on in my life, when I went into that choir, just like when I come into this interview, I'm with you. I have that ability to do that. And when you do that, you find that you can give your full self to whatever you are doing.
And you have that ability to do that because you have these rituals, Alina, in your life. You have these rituals where you take time to ground yourself. You take time to catch these thoughts and tweak them.
Yeah,
you take time to check in with yourself emotionally, and that's why you're 100% present. It's your rituals.
Talk a little. Do you have in your rituals gratitude? Because right now, I think people need to practice some gratitude big time.
And, And I'll tell you, so gratitude is one of the principles we teach in the 100-hour curriculum with the Mindfulness Leader Organization. Gratitude is so important. I'll tell you why. And this is going to be so exciting when you hear this. Gratitude. So listeners, gratitude has the same frequency as abundance. So now, right, where you're sitting at home because of this virus and you're feeling like everything is less than, less income, less everything, it's a great time to bring yourself up emotionally just by practicing gratitude throughout the day in your mind. It could be something as small as, oh, the Walgreens clerk opened the door for me, and go throughout the day being grateful for little things, so that if you decide to sit down and put it in a journal later on, I highly recommend that. It just all pours out. I've had a gratitude journal that I started about almost 21 years ago, and I still write in it. It's not every day, but it's a I am grateful journal. And I have to tell you, yep, it always elevates my mood. And who, yes, doesn't want to be in the frequency with abundance? It's the same frequency. And when you have gratitude, fear and anxiety don't live there.
Can't. It can't. Because so you're in gratitude.
It's a different frequency.
It fights the fear and the anxiety because, it just cannot exist. And yeah, that's the thing. You're taking the very best part of your day to move forward with. I mean, it's a big, giant plus to do that. All of a sudden, you've got a good vibration. You, yeah, feel this incredibleness as far as moving forward. Why go into the fear doubt?
Exactly. You don't need- but I do have to say, Elena, gratitude is hard if you've never sat down and done it before. And be easy with yourself. Just start off small, start off gently. You know, you're grateful you woke up today. You know, some people are not waking up today. I know it stinks to be in the house, but you're in a house. You're not in a third world country where, you know, you're just out there. So just practicing a little bit of gratitude every day will help you shift your vibration. And vibration just means your emotions, which also means the frequency you put into this world. And so you want to work on your emotional management. And this is a little great ritual to incorporate, which is gratitude.
So you are listening to Magical Moments, and we're giving you some incredible cool tools in the mindfulness realm so that you can start to build that wonderful feeling and that strength, meaning it comes from inside yourself. And it really is what we're teaching you to foster. So we'll be right back. We're going to talk more about this, and we got a special treat, so don't miss out.
Thanks for listening. Your weekend continues with Magical Moments featuring Elena Chapman right now.
Welcome back to Magical Moments for that ease and betterment in your life. And boy, are we trying to get you there today. And my name is Elena Chapman. I'm your host. Now, we're talking to Mona Antwerp. And I've been very impressed with some of the stuff she's saying about mindfulness. Mindfulness is really important in our lives. It really does deal with the thoughts, the vibration, and the becoming, which are three of the primary laws of the universal laws. And it's just something that when you do it, it betters your life. But Mona has a little bit of what I always talk about, and that is connecting to something bigger than ourselves, connecting to that inner divine in ourselves and something bigger, whatever you call that. And with that, I know that she helps. I want to start with a question, Mona.
Yes.
You know, and it is true. The gratitude helps. The getting out there and keeping yourself present is very important. But now you're adding a little spice to it. And those are good. But like I said, I think strength is not only from that belief inside yourself and what you build, but it's from that something bigger. Now, when you, so what do you call that something bigger? Where do you go with that? And how do you present that to kids and to people?
You know what? I call it intuition, and I also call it your GPS. Because just like a phone, you reach for your phone for directions, you could also go within for direction. So I use the word GPS because that's what the kids relate to.
Our guidance
system, but, you know,
yeah.
For us adults, it's just intuition, your inner guidance, your inner voice. It's that thing that you're born with, and it's always there, and it's connected to your higher self.
Yeah. And, you know, and it's really funny how we don't. When we, intuition is actually one of the six gifts of the spirit that we don't always, we've been taught to ignore. You know, oh, that's silly women's intuition. Men have intuition too, but for some reason yeah. The women's was silly. but also the imagination, which was discounted. Also the wonderful perception. Perception has been altered because it's all based on our intuition, our imagination. Reasoning, the will, and also the, memory, believe it or not, are all gifts of the spirit. So when you tap into intuition, it is your soul, your spirit, that is telling you what you need.
Yeah.
Because it's a gift.
And here's the secret. This is how you hear your intuition, your GPS, your inner guidance. When you practice mindfulness and you connect to your higher self by getting really quiet, it comes to you in thought form. So this is what it sounds like. This is what your higher self sounds like. You could be leaving the house and it'll be like, Mona, don't forget your keys. It's just my voice in my head. Don't forget your keys. And then I ignore that thought. And then I get to where I'm going and I have forgotten my keys. But that was my intuition trying to communicate with me. And if I am practicing mindfulness, then I am in flow and it's easy for me to connect. And if I'm disconnected, just like when you turn the lights off, you're disconnected. You miss that signal that comes to you in thought form.
See, and I really think where mindfulness really comes in is to get you into the position so that you can hear the intuition. You can hear. You cannot.
It's a gateway.
It's a gateway because you cannot hear that beautifulness inside you, that true divine place that's hidden, that only has this loving voice. I call it the soul. That beautiful place inside that's the true you, that is the spirit, that has this love.
Yeah.
And it feels like love too. It never attacks, but we choose to go with the attack.
Well, we haven't been trained. That's why this program was created. And it's a 100-hour curriculum. It's not a one-day thing. It takes the time to learn these principles.
That's the
good news, but really, you know you're connected to your higher self when you receive something in thought form and you feel really good. Now, if you receive a thought and it's that thought is telling you to go kick that cat in the street, you're not connected. That's not your higher self.
That's not
the thought you want to listen to. That's why I'm so big on where you are emotionally and constantly doing things to bring yourself up emotionally, because if you're high up on the emotional scale where you're hopeful and happy, then you are 99.9% connected to your higher self. It's just a matter of recognizing that voice and going with that voice. You know how you talked about
you're 100%. You're correct with that. Yeah. If you are listening, it's like a radio station. If you're listening to country Western music and you say, okay, I want to listen to Mozart, but you don't change the music you're listening to, you're not going to get the Mozart. So if you
gotta get on that channel.
If you're in a worried out fear or you're angry or you're in this mood, well, then you got to work through it and get out of it, because you can't get to where you're hearing that loving voice because you're not on the station.
Yeah.
You're not on the station.
Yeah. And it's okay not to be on that radio station. Okay. Because you can't live as a human and be happy and hopeful all the time. We're human.
No.
Things happen to us, but here's what you can do. Here's what you can do. You can make a list, and this will take some time. It's not something that can be done in one day, but you can make a list of everything that makes you move up the emotional scale. So for example, if you like to take a walk on the beach, put that on your list. If you like to dance, put that on your list. Make a list over the next week or two. In our program, the kids do it over 8 to 10 weeks. And then when they're low on the scale and they feel disconnected from their higher selves and they're low on the emotional scale, they refer to that page in their journal and they do those activities.
Oh, very good.
And those activities, those activities help them move up the scale. Also, if you are disconnected from your intuition, your GPS, any kind of movement that you could do, any kind of exercise, yoga, Pilates, anything, sports, do that. Because what happens is our emotions get stuck in our system and they have nowhere to go and they just fester within us. So you want to move them out by having some kind of activity.
Yes, an exercise. Fun. Having fun.
But you have to figure out what's fun.
You have to figure out what's fun. That might be for some, I don't know why. It might be running very far. Yeah. To me, that's not fun. To them, it is.
Right. For me, it's sitting with my pugs.
Yes, and you sit with your pugs, and I sit with my dogs. Or, you know, or I garden. For me, that's really fun. It's all, you have to figure out what is fun in your life. Yeah, and that feeds you. That is your nourishment. It really is, having fun.
Yeah.
All right, so if people want to get hold of you, how can they do that?
Yes, they can just go to our website, mindfulnessleader.org, and that's leader like you're the leader, mindfulnessleader.org, and you can connect with us, and our social media is on there too. You can also connect with us on social media. We do offer programs for schools, organizations, companies, groups. We work with everyone. And what people find is that these programs and these workshops are extremely fun. We're talking about a very boring subject, but I promise you, we have so much fun.
Yeah, it's that is important. So tell us a little bit, if person right now who is going through what we're going through, what is one of the best things they can do for themselves?
Ground yourself. First, ground yourself. You said you liked gardening, right?
Yes.
Yeah. Ground yourself. I was gardening yesterday for 4 hours. And I am addicted to connecting to my higher self, because that's the only place I want to flow from, so that I have my gift to give to the world. And we are all born with a gift. And so if you can ground yourself a little bit, have a little bit of gratitude, hear your thoughts and try to tweak them when you're having the bad thoughts. You can't do this all day because it's exhausting. But when those bad thoughts come up, just say it's not true and change the subject. And once you break your thought pattern, now you've broken that belief, because we have some messed up beliefs because we have been lazy with our thought pattern.
Yeah.
So everything starts in our mind and it trickles down to our emotions, and then it goes out into the world, and that's what we're transmitting. That's the frequency we're putting out. That's why it's so important to practice mindfulness.
It is. James Allen of As a Man Thinketh is one of my favorite books. It's one that I started with, actually. And it's the power of your thoughts. And it's quite true. What you believe is what you create. Now, so if you are doing something, but you haven't done the work inside, you haven't changed the beliefs. So say I'm going for this goal. I want to create a business, or let's use the business. So if I want to create a business and I have this nagging thought that keeps coming up that says, oh, you can't do that. It's not the time. That's a silly thought. And that keeps coming up. I haven't done the work to do anything to correct that. Everything, I'm going to start self-sabotaging. I'm going to start just deconstructing what I really want to do, because that thought is going to create the action.
Absolutely.
I think it was Gandhi had a whole long thing. You know, it creates the action, and it also is the vibration you're on. The opportunities are not going to come in with the synchronicities because I haven't done the work to change the thought. So what do you have for them to change the thought? Is there just a saying, that's not true? Or do you have some other things that you up your sleeve to help them deal with nagging thoughts?
Right. Is it appropriate to swear?
Well, they'll just bleep you out if they don't want it.
Okay. So, you know, when I'm working with people and that doesn't work where you tell yourself it's not true, that comes up, oh, you're not going to run a successful business. You don't have enough experience. Now's not the time. That thought comes up. If you say that's not true and that's not believable to you, you can say, now it's a whole different energy.
Yeah, that'll
now
get
you've just escalated it, you know? And so people laugh like you just did, but it's like a shock to your system. Like, and you're just saying it in your head, like you're standing up for yourself, and that's not your higher self. That's not your intuition.
No, it's
not. That's not source saying that to you. That's just you having fear and anxiety and being low on the scale. And that's why you're having those thoughts. That's why you want to monitor these thoughts and tweak these thoughts so that they are murdered as your beliefs. Because we have these beliefs that don't serve us.
That's right.
And they're all garbage. But if you don't take the time to take that garbage out in your mind, no one else could do this emotional mind work for you. You have to do it. And why not do it now while we're all at home?
Yes. Oh my gosh. If you're at home, folks, you know, and you don't have to be hard on yourself. You're already having, some of us are very frustrated right now. Some of us are getting it together and then kind of enjoying it. Some of us are building cool new relationships in our home, a cool new existence, but others are feeling very frustrated. We're eating too much. We're not feeling good. You know, just first of all, breathe, get outside and breathe. But then, you know, don't be so hard. We live in an experience. This is what we're here for, to experience life. So, all right, I don't like my thought right now. I don't like this down feeling I'm having. All right, I'm going to press my little reset button in my mind and say do-over. And I'm going to go outside and look at the sky. I'm going to bake some chocolate chip cookies for the kids. I am going to do A, B, and C a lot to just change this whole way that I'm doing and being right now. I'm going to change my vibration. Maybe I'll do some gratitudes. I'm going to change this up. It's up to us to recognize. Awareness is the key. If you have awareness, you have all the power. Just look at it and say, but is this really what I want? It's that simple.
It's so simple. Catching your negative thoughts, if you can do that, that's true leadership.
That's true leadership.
And I'm constantly catching my negative thoughts because here I am running a non-for-profit organization. I'm 3 years in. This is not my background experience.
I know.
I have a lot of thoughts that come to me to say, what are you doing? You have 6,000 kids on your waiting list. How are you going to gather up the funds? You want to run free program. How are you going to do this? Like, you're in over your head. And I have to stop and I have to say, you know what? That's not true. And if that's not enough for me, then I'm swearing. I need to walk away. I need to walk away from this email. I need to walk away from this document. Go catch my breath. Go refer to my list of things that make me happy. You just recited some. Go do that and then go back to that work. And then once you catch that thought a couple of times, that belief is then broken.
Turn on some music. Love music. So, all right. So we have how we can get hold of you and you have those rituals. You have a fabulous program and you're also on social media. If anybody looked you up on social media.
Yeah. If they go to mindfulnessleader.org, the social media is right there for them to click on and follow. It feeds into the website.
Perfect. Okay. And then for everyone out there, I know that where we are right now, some of us are having a very hard time. Others are thriving. Well, I would love it if we were all thriving. We're giving you the tools to start doing that. But I'll tell you, if things get too much, step outside. Take a look at the world. Take a look at the sky. Take a look at things. Breathe and say, you know what? I'm going to do some things to change this up. And if you do that, oh my gosh, you're going to change the whole experience, the whole incredible experience of being in quarantine, just with that simple one move.
So we have chatted with Mona and learned so much about our thoughts.
And I just wanted to say that, you know, calling upon the magic that around us everywhere, the spirit resides in everything. And when we start to open to that, we become even stronger. It's hard to do everything our own. You know, if you're a mom or a dad, you're worried about your family. If you're also taking care of parents, you're worried about your parents. You're worried about, and if the kids are where they're, you know, they're older and they don't want to stay in the house and you don't have much, you know, to do with someone who's 20 and yet they're coming in. There's just a lot of things that play and you're in control of so much. Some of us have lost our jobs, our businesses. We're trying to regroup in that area. There's just a lot going on. And I understand it is hard to carry on alone. So I don't usually talk about some of the stuff that I've been through, but I'll tell you, there was a time in my life when I didn't have any money. And I was, you know, I decided to stay in the state that I'm in and not go home because there was a recession. And because of that choice, I was told that there was no funds from the family, meaning no one was going to help me on my start. So I had furniture, I had a little bit of furniture, and I had $200. Now, I can tell you I was worried. I gave money to a homeless woman, and I thought, what am I going to do? I'm almost with her. We're going to be roommates. But I started to think, my God, what am I going to do? How am I going to live? And I could have sat in my house in that fear. I could have just sat in a chair, totally paralyzed by fear. But inside of me, I heard an urge. And that urge said, go to the river, go to the water. And my favorite place was a park that was downtown. And I thought, I'm going to go to the park. I'm going to go to the river. And I did. I drove to the park. And when I got there, I got out of the car and I went down and I sat at the banks of the river. And that's when life changed totally. Because it was the lessons of the river. It was that no matter what happens to this river, no matter how many pollutants people put in it, no matter what we do, we try to reroute it, we try to control it, we cut down trees around it, and yet that river keeps flowing. And more than that, everywhere that river goes, it creates life. You'll see birds come around, you'll see squirrels start to build its house near. You'll see all life start to build life, homes around the river. You'll see people start to come because water is life. And you don't see that river, of course, getting all worried and scared. You don't see it stop. It cannot be contained. And I thought to myself, I'm going to be like the river. I am going to flow. I'm not going to get angry. I'm not going to allow it to, and I'm not going to be set with this fear. I'm going to believe that no matter what, I will go on. I will be fine. And I am going to move forward. And when I got back to my car, there was a message on the phone from a girlfriend of mine who said, hey, Elena, I found a duplex and it's right in my neighborhood. Would you like to come see it? And that neighborhood was by that river, by the way. And I looked back at the river and I thought, yes. And I said, how much is it? And she said, it's $5,000 down. And I said, I still want to see it. And when we went to that place and we went to that apartment or that duplex, I fell in love. It had like a little parapet or a porch, but it was second level. So I just saw myself having tea there every morning with the plants. And I thought, oh my gosh, I love this cute little apartment. But it needed work. And before I could, you know, I asked how much it was and he was still at 5,000. And before I knew it, it's like spirit talked through me. It just said, you know what? If you let me work at this, you've got problems here, 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 here. Let me work at it. If you pay for the supplies and let me live here free, I'll make this as cute as a button. And he said, okay. Now, why I'm telling you this story is that if you stay in fear, you shut down all the communication with something better or bigger in your life. You have this wonderful feeling inside, these urges. That's spirit. That's your intuition. That's your imagination. Those are gifts of the spirit. And when you're in fear, you turn that off, and instead you listen to the ego. You listen to the critical mind that tells you, oh my God, we're being attacked. What am I going to do? What am I going to do? Put your body in a fight or flight, and you can't do anything. You just spin around in this world of fear. It just spins and spins, and it gets bigger and bigger and bigger. You've got to just stop. You've got to just stop. Step outside, look up at the beautiful sky, say, what can I learn from you? Open your mind, take a deep breath, and let it go. Breathe in, and allow the spirit fill you, your lungs, your body. Start to build the belief within you now that spirit is truly, if God is omnipotent, like we are always taught, that means that God is everywhere. And when you start realizing that, you never ever have to feel alone. It just takes you to step out of the fear and open to it. So in these times, try to remember these words and start to step out of it. Even if that's just walking outside and looking at the sky or sitting under the tree, you know, and saying, what lesson do you have for me? And everybody will have a different lesson. That's why it's spirit. Don't draw on your logical mind. Allow yourself to really just open and allow whatever comes to you be what it is. Okay? So that's my little bit of advice, and that is mindfulness. It's a little bit of a step further, but I'll tell you what. Right now, I think times call for drastic changes. So try this, and for heaven's sakes, just breathe. We will get through this. We are strong. We really are. We all have strength. We just have to draw upon it, and we have to grow it. And this is the way to do it. So if you want to learn more, or you're at a place where you really want to talk, guys, I have started this Green Terror group for you. The Green Terror group is a discussion and sharing group that we talk about this kind of stuff. Last week, we did talk about fear and ways to go past that fear. We talk about other things, how to start creating in this time. We talk about philosophies, concepts, everything that can be applied to your life to help you live better with that ease and betterment in your life. So if you're interested, go to soulmanifesto.com, and right there it pops right up, and you can click on it and sign up so that we can send you a link on Thursday nights at 7 o'clock. Also, if you're interested, on YouTube, I'm starting a wonderful More Time to Think Twice. So it's a wonderful little series that will give you creative things to think about. I'm not saying you got to write a famous novel or something. I'm just saying simple stuff, little ways that we can think twice because now we have the time. We can let this time just go by in a fury of fear and potato chips and movies on the TV. Or we can now have the time to think twice and start doing something we've always wanted, creating something. Creating no matter what. Why not create something we want? So if you're interested in that, my YouTube channel is Elena Chapman. So that is another thing we're doing. But the Green Terror group helps you to ask questions. So either one. So as always, stay connected to that wonderful divine inside you that holds so many answers. And then also
with arm's distance, but better on social media, stay connected to everyone else. And then always, always build and connect that powerful connection with Source. Have a beautiful day. This is Magical Moments with Elena Chapman.
This has been Magical Moments with Elena, featuring Elena Chapman. If you miss an episode, you can download it now from your favorite podcast platform, including iTunes, Spotify, TuneIn, CastBox, Deezer, Stitcher, and Google Podcasts.
Podcasts by Federated Media.